Is this your guy?
Yes. Hey guys, I want you to meet Pete Kelsey.
Pete, I'm a dragon. Hey, dragon.
Eric invited Pete Kelsey, who's a lidar expert, out to the ranch to help us with the follow-up investigation on Homestead Two. After our meeting last week with retired Army Colonel John Alexander, who believes that portals might exist there, we conducted a laser experiment to try and prove it. No definitive evidence was obtained, not surprisingly, but we did experience a sudden drop in temperature inside the old building. And then we saw a strange light in the field nearby, and that indicates that something was happening. We've got these sites at the end of the ranch that we'd really like to get a high resolution imagery of, and maybe even a 3D model if, you know, if that works out. That's what I do. Great. Get your equipment. Let's load up, and let's go down then. Let's do it! If the LiDAR scanning device that Pete has brought can create a 3D image of the homestead area, and we see anomalies in the visual data, such as bends or strange shapes that shouldn't be there, we can then pinpoint those exact spots for more precise investigations and hopefully figure out just what the heck is happening there. Y'all ready for this? Let's go! Let's do it! Well, what's going on here?
Well, this is what we call Homestead 2. This area right here is a hotbed of activity.
Obviously, we inherited a narrative around here, and a lot of the stories, well, and even some of the experience we have had personally have been centralized around the old homesteads.
Okay.
In addition to possible portal phenomena, there are lots of other stories about Homestead 2 going back more than a century, where early ranchers and native people believed they saw UFOs, heard disembodied voices, and even encountered mysterious wolf-like creatures. Last year, I had my own experience when I was hit by a dangerous spike of ionizing radiation, and right afterwards, really bizarre burn marks appeared on my face and my hand.
Anything we can learn about this place? I realize that this is just geometric data that we're getting, but that's where we start.
You want to just start here and then go through these?
Yeah, I think if we use the mobile handheld, we can make quick work of this. This piece of gear I have with me is a SLAM-based scanner called a hover map. So SLAM scanning. The SLAM stands for Simultaneous Localization and Mapping. Just think of it as an amazing laser scanner that can create super, super accurate three-dimensional data.
A LiDAR works by sending out infrared laser beams that will bounce off of any objects or structures in the local area. And this will ultimately bounce back and be detected and enable us to create a 3D replica of the entire area. Now this is going to help us look for strange phenomena that might be at Homestead 2 that we can't see with our naked eye.
So I'm just going to hit scan. It's going to take a second. You, my friend, are scanning. Off you go. You can walk at normal speed and just sort of paint the air.
Okay.
Just swing your arm in an arc, because the more that the scanner head is pointed at, the more data you're gonna get.
This is fun.
You want to make sure you move that side to side.
That's
more data you get.
Okay, I'm gonna go inside of this. I'm gonna poke my head back here. I don't mind telling you, this place is creepy. Okay, I'm coming back out.
Okay, sure.
And I'm going to swing to the left and catch this space between these two buildings.
Just sweep with it and you'll get more. I don't know how many times I have to tell you to do that.
Got it.
No, you really don't.
So I'm gonna finish this portion of the homestead and then I'll probably make a sweep back that way.
Okay.
Effectively, we've made a complete loop on this homestead.
Yeah, it's gonna be good data.
You got that covered?
Yeah, I think so. Alright, guys. We'll see you in a bit.
Yep.
Well, hello.
Hey, guys. How are you doing? Hello there. Hey, Tom. I want to introduce you to Roland, a very close friend
hey.
And confidant. Candace, nice to meet you.
Roland. This is Candace. I'm Tom. A couple weeks ago, the family of the late Junior Hicks, a man who spent more than 60 years documenting the high strangeness of D'Angelo Ranch in the Uinta Basin, shared some of his archived research to help us with our investigations. Roland McCook is someone who is not only referenced in Junior Hicks's research, but also claims to have had a traumatic experience right at Homestead 2. So while we were waiting for the LIDAR data to be processed, Thomas Winterton was able to get Roland to come and share his story. So you're very familiar with this area.
Yeah.
Yeah, it looks a lot different.
I bet.
Yeah, I was born and raised here in the basin. D'Angelo Ranch was approximately about 2 to 3 miles from my house. So about 10 years old, I'd go up on top of these mesas and hunt for rabbits. What I saw, it's always haunted me for years. I stayed mainly up on these ridges on the mesas, rabbit hunting, and that house down there at that time was abandoned with the trees around it. One of the homesteads.
Probably Homestead Two.
Yeah. So that's where things, I think, started for me.
Great, let's go.
Let's go. This is really important to hear these stories because it's painting a picture of what this ranch is all about and all the strange phenomena that happens here. You know, there's the science side, but there's also this human aspect involved. So how does it feel right now to be back here? Okay, I'm a little nervous, you know, to be honest, a little nervous. I think this is where it began here, everything from there. Everything went from there. Yeah. You okay? Yeah. So how did it start? Tell us. Like, walk us through every minute detail to the point you hyperventilate and pass out. Well, when we were up there, there was weather moving in, and we were looking for a place to shelter, get out of the weather. We came in here, and I didn't really want to go into all the way into the building, but the person I was with, he just said, come on in, let's get farther into the building. And so we went farther on in, and when we got in there, while we were waiting, I was looking out the door and I heard like scurrying, like something moving, and I turn, and farther in that back corner, some stuff fell over and just got knocked over. I told him, that sounds bigger than a raccoon. I took off, grabbed my gun, and out the door after it.
Wow.
We thought it was raccoons at the beginning. Raccoons or squirrels or mice running around, and then things started getting knocked over. And that's when we thought, well, there's something else going on in here. And then you get that kind of creepy feeling that there's something more. We were looking for tracks. We noticed there were human footprints.
In the snow.
In the snow, yeah. And I followed the tracks, and then all of a sudden it turned from human footprints to big dog tracks, like a wolf. And it came out, red eyes, probably like 8 feet tall, and then it just pointed at me. Whatever it is doesn't belong here. We started shooting. He had a semi-auto. Pop, 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 pop. And all you hear is the biggest, loudest roar I've ever heard. And after that, it was gone. We took off.
I've heard that this ground here is the gateway for these shapeshifters, or these D'Angelos.
Yeah.
The legend of the D'Angelo really initiated back in the mid-1800s. This is when the Navajo and the Utes got into more than a skirmish. The Utes, they say, were abusing the Navajo at the time, using them somewhat as slaves. And the Navajos ended up cursing the Utes.
And the Sherman family, who lived on the property in the 1990s, they encountered these giant wolf-like creatures, and the Native Americans would refer to as skinwalkers, D'Angelos, that started attacking their cattle and were literally impervious to, you know, to gunshots.
What happened after that? We got home. I would hear things at night. I'd lay down, put the pillow on my head, and they'd come around and you could hear their hands or claws just like going across the building, growling the whole time. And it's still, you know, that it, the vibration and everything right to your soul, and I just like, what did we do?
Yeah.
Hold on. Whoa. Is something hurt? Are you okay? Yeah, I got a little dizzy there.
Hold on to me.
I think I'm okay now.
Why don't you hang on to me?
He was obviously very emotional, and it all came to a head when he just about passed out on Tom. I could see his eyes roll back in his head as he turned and looked at me and said,
"No."
I think I reached my breaking point. And I said, "Roland, I have too."
You okay?
Yeah. Strangely enough, where Roland almost fainted was right in front of the cistern behind Homestead Two. There have been some strange events that have happened in that exact spot. That's where Travis Taylor got radiation burns, and people visit that go catatonic and just lose their sense of place and time. You still dizzy?
No, I'm good. Yeah.
This area here can really... You can get disoriented really, really fast. Yeah. It's almost like it just creeps up on you. So there is something out here, Roland.
Yeah. I think you're still a little shaky, man. I'm just gonna stand right here with you. What I saw, I think it was a skinwalker, a D'Angelo, and the feeling that I got, that fear I had of it, came back. That's hard to explain. If you wouldn't mind, guys, I'd like to be here by myself and have a moment.
Absolutely. Just a little bit of closure. I knew I needed to come back here for me to get this closure. With that sage, I'm praying to my God, my Father, to help me move past thousands, to protect me once I leave, so nothing will follow me back. Thousands. Hopefully this helps it find its peace and move on. Time will tell on this.
I'm a firm believer that there are things that are unknown to us, and I think it got into his psyche. My prayer is with Roland to hopefully bring closure to 40 years of being tormented by this phenomenon.
So did you say Tom got Roland off the ranch?
Yes, he did safely escort him.
Okay.
So after we heard about Roland, he became disoriented and nearly passed out at Homestead 2. That's a little scary. We decided to load up in the truck and get out there and see if we could find anything. And we took all of the equipment that I had and we just went out there and measured the crap out of it.
I don't know if this gentleman had a medical issue or what, but given my experience at Homestead 2, we brought Geiger counters, dosimeters, and tri-field meters out there in case unusual levels of radiation could be detected that would indicate if something out of the ordinary was happening. Eric, you got that Geiger counter rolling?
Oh, it's rolling!
My dosimeter's on.
Okay.
Roland was in front of me, in front of the cistern. We were all looking toward the field.
Yeah, so he was standing here. He kind of turned to me, his eyes rolled back in his head, and he just kind of landed on Tom. Did you guys have a tri-field meter or a spectrum analyzer? Or a dosimeter? Nope. We're going to come into places like this, like Homestead 2 or Homestead 3, or places, you know, other than just, you know, around the house in your robe or something. I think we need to figure out, you know, which instruments we should always take with us in case something like that does happen. Then we actually get the data.
Oh, yeah!
And make sure that you're not being exposed to something. Can't all just go walking in there willy-nilly, people.
I told you we should bring our dosimeters, and you said, oh no, it's fine, Candace. What could possibly go wrong, Candace? And look what happened. Roland nearly passes out on Tom, and we end up getting scolded by Travis in front of everybody.
I wish you guys could have been here and just kind of experienced this guy, because he's a real deal. And I felt, you know, I felt what he was feeling. Well, we'll tell you that I'm seeing unusually high magnetic level, field level, right in the area that I wasn't finding right there. And this is backing it up, too. So two instruments here I'm seeing. What are we looking at on the radiation spectrum? Anything?
It's troubling.
We're getting neutron counts that I don't think we should be getting. So, I want you all to go on and move around, all right? Eric and I will kind of sweep and see if we can find it. Okay, we'll just move to the front of the homestead area. You guys good?
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Yeah, where in the hell are neutrons coming from? It wasn't a dangerous level of neutrons, but again, it was a higher than normal level, which is an anomaly. Now, I don't know if it's connected to what happened to Mr. McCook, or if our experiments here on Homestead 2 could be stimulating a response from something that is still unknown to us. What I do know is that Homestead 2 needs to remain the focus of our investigations right now on D'Angelo Ranch. Now everybody, make sure we don't detect anything that's dangerous before we let people just come wandering around in here. Thank you for indulging us and racing us out here.
Oh, of course.
Hey, guys. Hey, Pete.
Hey, Pete. Welcome back.
Did you get all that data crunched?
I did.
Pete Kelsey is back with us for a return and report. Having crunched all the data collected during his surveys out of the Homestead 2 area, we're all anxious to review and to see if anything unusual shows up, which we all know something is going to. But I'm excited to go through the data.
Okay, I want to show you the SLAM LIDAR. You, Eric, took the hover map and went for a walk around the structures, the buildings. That is what this is. Now, admittedly, it's pretty dirty. Well, let's kind of walk through it. Just see if we see anything. Now that we have a precise 3D image of the buildings and all the trees and the foliage at Homestead 2, we can examine the site from different angles and look for any unusual phenomena in the area that we wouldn't be able to see with the naked eye.
It really does have a spooky appearance, doesn't it? Appropriately.
What I like is that we can see through it right now. It's very ghostly. Whoa, what is that?
I mean, that's not a data point, right? There should be a lot more data points right there with the two rooms. I mean, you walked in there.
Something odd happened here. So here's the house, in the back. I mean, look how well this is all covered up here. Let me zoom back out.
Okay.
So there's the top of it, all right? What happened to all this data right here? I mean, where is it? Where'd it go? Can't explain it. It's like there's data missing. The SLAM scan LIDAR data is showing the foliage and the outlines of the buildings. But where we should be seeing the inside of the main house, it's just a black hole.
And the data that you do have came from the door, not from being inside.
Holy cow. Look at that. And that means when you walked inside the building, it didn't take any data.
Guys, I dwelt for minutes inside of these rooms. There should be tons of data here that we're not seeing.
That is spooky, boys.
The only data that you got was from the outside in.
I mean, what is it about this spot inside that building?
So, Pete, have you In your time of doing this, have you seen other models that are similar to this, where you are lacking data in a place that you definitely walked through?
The short answer is no, because I was with Eric. He was in that room and the hover map was working. That's just strange to me.
Since the SLAM scanner appears to have gotten good data everywhere at Homestead 2 except inside the old house, I don't know how to scientifically explain that. All I can think about is how Colonel John Alexander told us he believes there could be a portal at that location.
Man, it's crazy. I mean, something odd is happening right there.
Well, the data keeps adding up that we can't get data at that spot.
Or something doesn't want us to get the data there, right? Well, I gotta tell you that it gives us some things to think about. Some points that we need to go look at.
Guys, this really meets and exceeds my expectations. I'm thrilled to have these data.
Thank you. All right. See ya.
Thanks, Pete.
There he is. How you doing, Ariel?
How you doing, brother? Good to see you, man.
I've worked hard with this team to do everything we can think of to apply hard science in our investigations of the strange phenomena that keep happening at Homestead 2. We tried ground-penetrating radar, laser scanning, lidar scanning, drilling, and even excavating and got no definitive answers. All I know is that when we poke this nest, weird things seem to happen. So I've decided to invite a special guest to see if his methods can help.
Ariel, I'm Eric Barr.
Eric, nice to meet you.
You too.
Ariel Tibidea.
Rabbi Ariel Thibodeaux is not only a scholar and a teacher of Judaism, but also an expert in how that belief system might explain the portal phenomenon that we've been investigating. I don't generally conduct mystical experiments or rituals, but at this point, I don't know what we have to lose.
I was just telling the guys that you were explaining to me how the Jewish faith looks a little differently at some of these strange phenomena than the Christian faith.
Why are you looking
So I don't get it wrong. Why don't you just explain that? All right, let's go back to a little bit of Bible study. The Bible makes mention of other indigenous races upon our earth.
I'm not a scientist. I'm a clergyman, and I came to look at what is expressed here, not from a point of a scientific anomaly, but from a spiritual point of view.
Recognize that the Bible does speak of these entities. They exist in what in religion we'll call a spiritual plane. I guess maybe in modern terminology you might consider that a fourth dimension of space. You're the scientist. You'll discover that. What seems to be happening here is that there very well might be an indigenous earth spirit who has called this place home for as long as it has been alive. And the one thing that they find the most offensive is when human beings encroach upon their domain. There are times on this property where you get the sense of malevolence a little bit. This reality, which we think is the only reality, isn't. You could actually have portals opening and closing on this property with a living, non-human, intelligent entity. Coming and then disappearing. Coming and then disappearing.
Now, Ariel has told me that the Hebrew rabbis know of a thing called tonal technologies. It's an acoustic technology that is believed to be able to open up the heavens or a pathway or a doorway. A portal, if you will.
My method, I believe seeing is believing. So what I believe to do is teach others to see for themselves. That's what it's all about. So let's talk about how we're going to do that now. We are going to create a sacred place and do the traditional prayers for opening of the gates. We will specifically invite whatever is here, if it's willing, to communicate, to show some sign. Because these entities are out there. I already sense it. Holy
What is that?
We
We got something! Hold on! Hold on! Right there!
Yeah, I see it.
Oh yeah, I see it now.
It's where it was last time. It just went away. Dang it! Right under the sun, and it was right in that portion of the sky.
Well, Ariel is talking to us about how he hopes that he can reach whatever the phenomena is here on the ranch. Suddenly, we notice to the west there's something glowing in the sky.
It's been popping up in that same spot it always pops up in. Did you see it? You saw it, right?
Oh, I saw it. I conjured it.
Oh, my Tanya, it's back. Oh, my Tanya. There it is again, right there. It's gone again. It's in the same place every time. Same exact spot. Yes.
This object that we're seeing, it shows up. It glints really brightly and then disappears as if into a speck. It was pretty crazy.
Now it's gone.
So, guys.
Yeah?
The transponder data received is run, or the transponder data receiver is running, cameras are running. I think we need to get out to the homesteads and start our process.
Let's go, let's load up, let's get there, let's go talk to it, let's do it!
Thomas Winterton always says when new people come on the ranch responds to it.
I've got everything I need, I'm ready.
I don't know what to think, but it's weird that just as Rabbi Thibodeaux has come to D'Angelo Ranch for the express purpose of trying to reveal portal phenomena, we clearly see something glowing and then disappearing in the sky.
I don't know what that was, but I saw it.
You know, Travis has talked about wanting to poke the hornet's nest and see what comes flying out. Well, we're about to. We'll see what happens.
I'll tell you right now, I'm really excited for this ceremony.
Absolutely. Well, here we are. This is Homestead 2 right here. This is a good place. This is a rock. Let's see if we can work with it. At this time, we're going to create a sacred space, and if there's an entity out here which feels that we are intruding, this will be a place as an offering of peace, as if saying, no, we are not here to encroach. We are not here for harm, because these entities, they understand energy, and if they feel the place power or the power of holiness, this place will become like a campfire, a warm place on a cold night. So let's see if we can find some rocks.
You bet.
To put around here.
So, like, how big and how many?
Just enough to cover.
Okay.
So, like 2 to 3 feet away from the center stone?
That would be fine. Okay.
As an astrophysicist, I approach every experiment using the scientific method. But as a scientist, you have to be open to examining a problem from all points of view to find a potential solution. Maybe a more exotic approach is what we need for this experiment to actually yield results.
Dragon, that's good. You don't need any more? All right, then.
All right, well, we got all our gear, so I think it's time we start setting up for nighttime. Let's grab our stuff, guys. Let's do it!
Let's see what happens. I guess those just go by the table, Dragon. The Pelican cases, and we'll work on the computer, and got to set up the audio system, so we'll get all that set up later.
Okay.
Travis.
Yeah?
Where should I put this?
Let's go right over there, buddy. Right okay. On that table we got set up for you there, buddy.
Yay!
Rabbi Thibodeaux told us that according to religious doctrine, this particular tonal ceremony could only be effective if performed after dark.
Yeah, this will be interesting.
Yeah, it's been interesting so far. So in addition to our spectrum analyzers and tri-field meters, which will detect any anomalous energy spike if something happens, we're also going to set up infrared cameras with night vision to document anything out of the ordinary that might not be visible to the naked eye, and a thermal scanner to monitor strange drops in temperature.
Hey guys, I think the mic stand should go right about there.
And finally, we're going to make a recording during and after the rabbi ceremony to capture any strange audio frequencies or unnatural sounds that may occur out here tonight.
Looks like we should be good. Eric, you about got that camera situated?
Yeah.
We good, Eric?
You've got the forward-looking infrared camera set up and ready and recording. We've got the night vision goggles. Oh, I can't wait to see those. Are they set up on the camera? Are they gone? Tell me something!
Yeah, the NVG is rolling as well. They're both trained on the Homestead area and the trees above.
All right, we've got the microphone connected to speakers, and we're going to be blasting that. But we are also recording it. And any other sounds that the microphone picks up will be recorded in that. We can look so that we can look at it later. And back in my trailer, we've got the spectrum analyzer specterizing, running, measuring all the microwaves from the antennas pointing this way. So we're good, buddy.
And that's all being recorded as well?
That's all being recorded, yeah.
Okay.
You're doing great, buddy. So if something happens, I mean, hopefully we'll catch at least parts of it. Hopefully. Many of the stories have been told about this place is that there have been opening of portals. Through the centuries, many of the sages, prophets, shamans, and the like have recognized that there are certain types of sounds, harmonics, we call them chants, that can somehow influence the movement or interactions with these portals. What I'm going to be doing now is the traditional evening prayers that are recited at this time in our Torah tradition. So gather around, children. So on that note, if everybody's okay, I'm going to begin. I do sense a presence in this land, and I sense that this is a very old presence here. I asked for its permission to be here. I asked if I could give a blessing to the land, because this is the land which God has made, and it's the role of a rabbi, of course, to be a conduit of the blessings of God. So Ariel starts the ceremony, and while he's doing the chant, I happen to notice that there's some kind of anomaly in front of the doorway of Homestead 2. Eric, come here a minute.
You seeing something?
Look at the difference in the FLIR imagery now. It's completely changed.
I have not seen this do this before.
It should not have changed that drastically all of a sudden, Eric. The FLIR imagery completely changed. It's like the canopy of the trees were super hot, and everything underneath it, where the house is, I mean, look at it. Look, it's just completely cold. Yeah, it's like in temperature layers now. It shouldn't have changed that drastically all of a sudden.
One of the most unexpected and interesting artifacts that we see during this exercise is that immediately after the ceremony had drawn to a close, the temperature around the homestead itself began to drop. Oh, let me find a better word for that. Oh, it began to plummet. Yeah, that's a better word.
That's usually indicative of a presence. Remember, these entities are always described as being cold. So what that means is suddenly the treetops are super warm, and everything underneath it got super cool. Super cool. Guys, look now. Look right here.
You see
how the heat is coming down the tree? This tree, and it's heating up around the area, this area, and it's creating this cold vortex in the middle suddenly. That is odd. And now it's heating up. Look, now it's heating up in the middle of it. Suddenly the temperature over the homestead area turns extremely hot. And then it starts to fall and it wraps around the homestead. I'm not sure what is going on with Homestead 2, what it is about the place. But since I have been here, we've measured crazy radio and microwaves down there. I had radiation exposure symptoms from a signal that appeared to be gamma rays. It was really strange. I'm fine now. But I almost died. Guys, I'm going down there.
You better take something with you.
Yes, I want the spectrum analyzer. Eric, why don't you guide us right in here? Please keep an eye on the monitor.
Okay.
And if something changes, let us know.
All right.
There's some kind of an anomaly going on down here at Homestead 2 where alleged portals had been seen. And now we're seeing an anomaly through our FLIR camera after a rabbi does a ceremony to open portals? There is nothing going to keep me from going down there to see what's going on. Thomas, Dragon, and I, we need to take instruments down there right now. Guys, I'm going to start recording on this camera.
Hey, come here. Feel the difference?
Wow, it's freezing right here, guys. Freezing!
It is freezing cold.
It is absolutely cold right here. Oh my goodness.
Okay, guys, you are right in the center of that region.
It is freezing cold right here in front of the homestead. As soon as we walked in front of homestead number 2, it was probably 20 degrees colder. I mean, it was instantaneous, like walking into a walk-in freezer or something like that.
That's crazy. We're looking at, it's like, almost like an eye. There's a black section surrounded by purple, and it's like receding in the closer you guys get to it.
Man, it is bloody cold in here.
I'm shocked to have the temperature difference.
Yeah, that is strange. I mean, we've been out here how many times? I've never felt a difference like that. Well, that's just kind of spooky, guys.
The rabbi told us that the presence of entities or beings or spirits has been described as being very cold. So it makes me wonder if we weren't walking through some type of spirit or entity, you know, another dimension that we could feel but we couldn't see.
Interesting and odd at the same time.
It's so hard because you can't really quantify a feeling.
You can't quantify a feeling, that's exactly right, Tom. That's the problem. Hey, are you guys seeing anything?
It'll be easier if you come back here and I'll explain it.
Let's go head back and see what they've got to say. It sounded like they had something interesting. Thomas, Dragon, and I were completely amazed, startled, and confused by the strange temperature vortex or anomaly. I can't explain any of this stuff. While we didn't see a monster crawl out of it, who knows what a portal is supposed to look like? We couldn't see it with our naked eyes, but we did see it with the infrared camera, so who knows?
When you guys started walking down there, you could see this whole area warming up. And there was a purple, like, it looked like an eye right there. It was purple with a black section right in the middle of it.
Well, that's a cold, probably.
It almost was like you were chasing something that way.
Well, I'll tell you what we need. We need 4 or 5 more nights as a baseline to compare this to.
Well, I'd like to do that. I'd like to go back and look at the data. There are just so many things I want to do, guys. I can't wait to see this replayed once Eric gets the data from the forward-looking infrared camera and we can analyze it.
This is only one more chapter in a never-ending story. This will continue. You will have other episodes, more revelations, more insights. You are here for a purpose.
Well, thank you very much, Ariel.
Thank you all for having me.
So, I'm looking at the thermography footage from Rabbi Ariel's prayer, and I'm seeing some things that I would like to get your eyes on.
I'd love to see it. That was an interesting night.
Yeah, it was very interesting. Last night, Rabbi Ariel's ceremony definitely left an impression on all of us. I can't say for sure that what he did caused a portal to open at Homestead 2, but the 20 degree temperature drop inside the old house structure was undeniable. And now that Eric has analyzed the thermal footage and all of the data, I'm eager to find out what else we may have documented that wasn't obvious in the moment.
So I've got us queued up to the point where the Rabbi Ariel completed what he was here to do. You know, that's pretty much what it looked like most of the time. And then, all of a sudden, this is all rapidly changing.
Whoa. Look how it got cold immediately, more than just in that doorway. Wow. That was like instantaneous.
We are talking on the order of 10, 20 seconds.
10 or 20 seconds. The entire thermal area, the whole place, there, changed. Look how much colder it's getting.
It's really dropping. And then, if you focus on this part right here...
Yeah, as we're walking in right there, the spot is like super cold in one spot, and then everything else around it is just hot.
Like really hot.
Look at that.
Well, I remember when we walked in there, it was like getting hit with a wall of cold.
Like you walk into a freezer.
It wasn't a gradual thing, it was just a...
And look at the difference. I mean, it's like a vortex or of cold right there. And everything else around it is just super hot. Even the ground underneath it. I mean, look, is hot. Ariel said that if he was going to open up a portal, it might not look like we think a portal is going to look like.
I remember that.
And what we see here, whether it's a teleportation portal, you know, I can't say anything to that. I don't know what to say about it other than something caused the temperature to change dramatically in a localized spot. It's just crazy.
So, we have a localized effect analogous to the portal. There is one other feature that I don't know what to make of it, but I want you to see this thing. It only happens once. It's very fast.
Where are we looking at on the screen?
Well, first I want to see if you notice it. Play a little game, if you will.
Okay.
So, I think we're looking at a total of maybe 7 or 8 frames.
Whoa, whoa.
Whoa.
Whoa, what was that, guys?
Right there, that.
Okay, now I'm frame advancing. So, what is that?
What?
Hardly seems possible. What the heck is that?